Yeah, welcome everybody. I think we can start. Before we go into the topics that I prepared, so the topic was stellar clustering, and we were looking at what's the observations, what does theory tell us, and I prepared two sections. So one is on the virial theorem, that's basically from a couple of exercises on star formation, and where we look at how the virial theorem is used to make statements on star clusters. Here in this particular example, it's clusters of galaxy, but the same argument also works when you look at stellar clusters. Okay, so the virial theorem, as we saw in the lecture, basically tells us if we have a bound system, how is like the energy distributed between the total potential and kinetic energy of the members of this cluster. So it's clear that the potential energy needs to be higher than the kinetic energy, otherwise the things would just run apart. And virial theorem states that in equilibrium, the potential energy is twice the kinetic energy. So this is a general statement. So this also, of course, holds for large scale objects like galaxy clusters, as it does for star clusters, but basically also for point particles as atoms in a molecular cloud, maybe. Okay. Now, if we look at a star cluster or a cluster of n objects with mass m that has a certain average radius, of course, this is kind of a dynamic figure because everything moves around, so to actually define a radius is somewhat like not that easy, and it changes maybe a little or fluctuates. But let's say we have an average radius, then we can calculate the escape velocity of one of these objects, so let's call it a star for the moment, and we know that the escape velocity from a cluster is just the velocity at which the kinetic energy of this star exactly equals the gravitational potential. So that's just the energy it needs to get out of the potential of the well. And that's therefore the minimal energy that such a star needs to become unbound. The total force on a star in such a cluster is the sum of all the gravitational interactions, so all the two-body interactions with all the other stars. So the gravitational potential is typically the sum of the two-particle potential energies for all the stars. So when we look at the system, then the total energy of one star is the sum of the kinetic and the potential energy, so that's of course the kinetic energy given by its velocity, and n minus 1 times the gravitational potential. So we have many simplifications here. So for example, we assume all the stars have the same masses, and so on. On average, they are all r apart, with the argument that in such an object, the mean separation is on the order of the radius of the thing. So this is really a rough estimate. So the minimal velocity is that which basically puts this sum to zero, so that gravitation and potential energy, that gravitation and kinetic energy just cancel out. So we set this to zero, and when we then rearrange the whole thing, this is our expression for the potential, for the escape probability here. So sorry, my system is somewhat slow here. So depends on the number of stars with mass m, and basically the size of the cluster. Okay. Now we can, when we look at this cluster and say it's in equilibrium, we can compare this escape velocity to the typical velocities of a star inside the cluster. And this is given by the square root of like the time average of a velocity squared. So that accounts for the vector characteristic, of course. So when we start from the virial equilibrium, we are not looking at an exact balance between kinetic and potential energy, but we know that 2 times kinetic energy, mean kinetic energy, is the potential. So this is zero, and again with our assumption we have n stars of mass m, typical distance r, we can write down the potential energy now as this. And here we are looking at the 2-point interactions between all the stars, so not one star between all the others, so but all stars with all the other stars. That's where this factor n times n minus 1 comes from. And we have to divide by 2 because we count every relation twice when we just take n times n minus 1. And the total kinetic energy of the cluster, so we are now talking about the energy of the whole system, is given n times the kinetic energy of the stars, and the kinetic energy depends on this mean velocity here. So again, this is a time average because the velocity changes, of course, on large scale when these objects, like oscillate through the cluster. So I'm having here some lag of video and my screen. Is it also that this looks choppy on your side? Okay. Because here this looks not like a network issue, but like here a local thing on my machine. So I hope that we don't crash like a couple of weeks ago. Okay. So this is the total kinetic energy. And when we just put this all into the equation from the virial theorem, we can write down the mean squared velocity as a function of the total mass. So basically, this is the numerator as the total mass, more or less, divided by the size. And using this, we can compare the escape velocity with this equation. So we come here, so this is 2 times, which is not really surprising given that we have like 2 times the potential energy equating the kinetic energy from the virial theorem compared to kinetic energy equals potential energy from the earlier thing. So this is basically on the cluster scale, on the scale of individual stars, you will have, of course, many interactions. So all the stars like fly through each other. You have basically collisions in the sense that you have gravitational interaction of affecting the velocity, and maybe also one star or like a cluster accelerating another star that gravitationally collides with this. And so it happens that individual stars might be accelerated and basically evaporate from this cluster on very large time scales. Okay. Now when we look at a coma cluster, which is basically a system of a couple of 100 galaxies that are bound by gravity, then it's already known for a long time that things are somewhat more complicated as what the eye sees. So in 1933, Zwicky studied the coma cluster. And you can calculate the mass of the coma cluster in two different ways. So this is now always trying redoing these calculations from almost 100 years ago. The first, what we can do is we can just count the galaxies and multiply the number of galaxies with the mean number of stars or the mean stellar mass per galaxy. This gives us like a rough estimate of the total mass. Stellar mass. Okay, you can argue, okay, is this all the mass or so? Maybe there is also gas and dust, but most of the mass that we that is in stars. So when we do this, it's we find something like almost 10 to the 12 solar masses. So note that this number is much smaller than the mass of the Milky Way. So the Milky Way is, or the Andromeda Nebula is already a relatively large galaxy. But there are many more much smaller galaxies. So when we look at the local group, like this is 30, 40, 50 galaxies, and the two big galaxies are the Milky Way and the Andromeda Nebula. The rest is something like the Magellanic Clouds or IC 342 or some other galaxies that are in the neighborhood. Okay. But what we can also do is we can use the virial theorem, look at this cluster of galaxies, try to measure their velocities, and then since they are bound, the velocity, which is like a diagnostic of the total kinetic energy in this cluster, relates to the total potential energy, which is a function of mass. So the size is about 0.3 megaparsec, and the velocity dispersion, which is basically the square root of the mean squared velocity, is in the order of 1,000 kilometers per second. So what we are now looking at is not the visible stellar mass, like in the section above, we are looking at the dynamical mass. So that basically informs the gravity. So, and doing this, we can compute the dynamical mass from the virial theorem like this. So this is the result from the virial theorem that we had here for the mean velocity. And we multiply this by n minus 1. And yeah, so that's basically the equation we had before. And we measure the velocity, and we measure the size, and we count the object. So we can basically directly compute the mass that is responsible for the size of the cluster and the velocity its particles have on average. Now, you have to be careful a little bit, because what we measure is only the radial velocity, so the projection of the velocity vector along the line of sight, because we measure just the Doppler effect of the galaxy. We cannot measure like the perpendicular directions. And so it's not possible to observe eigenvelocities of galaxies, because this is just too small an effect over the time scale that we have for measurement. So we have to make some statistical arguments. So what we measure is this, the radial component of the velocity, and when we assume that the velocity components are about equally distributed for all coordinates, then we can statistically say, okay, the actual dynamic mean velocity dispersion is three times the observed radial velocity that we find. So that's when you say that everything is running through each other. The argument is a little bit different if you say you have particles and they are just rotating. Then the factor is, I think, is two, because you have no like radial component so much, but just like everything is running on circles. But like there's some uncertainty here, how we compute the dispersion from what we measure. And that's because we just actually don't know in detail. Okay, but so what this is like a factor of two uncertainty. Yeah, you will see in a second why this doesn't matter. Because when we insert the numbers, what we now get is 4 times 10 to the 14, while we had 8 times 10 to the 11 solar masses earlier. So what we have here is a difference in the mass that we determine by a factor of few hundred, at least, depending on whether we look at the visible matter in form of stars or the gravitationally active matter visible in the velocity of the galaxies. So what we have to conclude is that like 99% basically of the matter that needs to be somewhere in this coma cluster is invisible. That's where the argument for dark matter, so that's one of the arguments for dark matter. And it's still one of the strongest arguments, because it's very difficult to explain this otherwise. Yeah. Okay. So that's a typical application of the virial theorem on cluster systems. And in that particular case also gave rise, or is one of the pillars of dark matter hypothesis. Or let's call it theory, because that we need some gravitationally acting matter that we cannot detect otherwise. Okay, do you have questions on that? Okay, so I will keep looking at the chat from time to time. So if something comes up, write it in the chat or briefly interrupt me via audio. Okay. Good. So the second thing I wanted to show is that when we were talking about the clusters and the observations, we were also looking at how to quantify the actual distribution of stars that we, of these point sources that we observe on the sky, and how to compare it with the distribution of like continuous quantities like density distributions of molecular clouds or something like that. And we presented the two-point correlation function, which is a statistical measure to quantify typical separations of objects in a basically n-dimensional configuration. And I wanted to show you one other application of the two-point correlation function and how to actually compute this in practice, because as we already saw in the notes, this is actually only defined for continuous functions and not for discrete functions. Okay. So this is one application that I also sometimes use in the data analysis course. When you look at the distribution of galaxies on the sky, so if you look at catalogs or at images, then you note that they are not uniformly distributed, but that there is some non-uniformity. So galaxies form clusters, filaments, there are gaps, voids in between. So it's different from what you would get when you just randomly create positions in X and Y on the sky. And even though sometimes it looks more or less homogeneously distributed, there is still discernible structure in these positions. And to make the point, I have 6 data sets of basically stellar positions on the sky. One of these 6 data sets is from an actual stellar catalog, and all the other 5 are just randomly created. And if you look at the screen now, I'm pretty sure that it's for all of you impossible to tell me which of the data set is the true one. At least I hope so. Okay, so just a brief like technical remark here. Should I maybe restart my system, or is it understandable with the like hanging video and sound from time to time? No, I note that my system from time to time, my video here and my screen sometimes hangs, and I from your side want to hear whether you still can follow what I'm talking, or if it's just too choppy and too interrupted to like follow. Okay, good. So then I just continue. Good. Okay. So, and one way of the correlation function is to statistically analyze how the individual points in these maps are distributed by looking at how common are certain distances. When we measure the distance between all stars to all the other stars, we should note whether you have, for example, some statistically significant clustering, which we know takes place in real system, that might be different from the Poisson clumping that we see here. So even here we have like areas where we have no points, you have like small clusters of points, or here and here. But this is just a typical result of like random sampling. Okay, so what I would like to do in the coming like 20-30 minutes or so, walk you through an estimate of the 2-point correlation function for these six fields of stars, and check whether we can figure out which one is the real data set. So here the side notice is that I don't know which one is the real data. Yeah. Okay. So the task is we have to estimate the 2-point correlation function in unit of the angle, and the angle is here the angular distance between these points, and for our application we just take the Cartesian distance between points in units here of the x and y axis. Note that when we compute the distance, there are some like more complex points here involved statistically, that, for example, this is a finite data set. So if you take the point here in the top left, you get distance like maybe 10 to the next point, but you can get this distance to this point here. So you get a very long distance. If you look at the point in the center, the maximum distance from this data that you get is like at least a square root of 2 smaller. So we have some edge effect that you can get this distance here, and then you have like the full diagonal available, while when you look at this star, it looks, you have a somewhat different distribution because you don't have the same extent of the data set in all directions. This introduces a certain bias into an estimate, and this needs to be corrected. So we will see this in a second. There are like a number of statistical estimators, like approximations of the true 2-point correlation function. And we will look at two. The one is the natural estimator called W1 here, and something that's been proposed by Lundy and Salai that tries to correct for some of these effects. Okay. Let's look a little bit at some theory first. When we have in such a map clustering, then we have, and we measure the distance of all stars to all the other stars, we have a certain overabundance of a small, of close pair distances, because we have a certain fraction here that are significantly closer together as what is true for the average. So, so the clustering increases the number of close pairs, and this estimator for the for the this two-point correlation estimator quantifies this increase as a function of the separation between points. And this fractional increase increases relative to the random distribution of the probability delta p, which is basically the probability to find two objects that are separated by a certain angle, each in its own solid angle element. And this is expressed like this, where here this zeta is the surface density. And we have here two artificial data sets. Let me make the screen somewhat smaller here. We have two artificial data sets. Our system is hanging here, where we have two different types of clustering. So on the right hand side, you have like an underlying field of stars that are randomly distributed, or galaxies, and then you have like these dense clusters, which are like galaxies sitting closely together. And on the left hand side, we have a different clustering, which is less apparent to the eye, where we have like on a larger scale things sitting closer together. So can I change the maybe let's make this a little bit smaller, because I want to have this on one screen. So, and on the bottom, for each of these two maps, I plot here this estimator function W as a function of theta. So for different distances here on the x-axis, we have this estimator here that basically modifies the uniform distribution, which corresponds to the one here. And when we look at the two, you see that, for example, here, you have an overabundance of stars for small separations. This corresponds here to these cluster thingies, which goes down when we have a lot, which goes down here when we are closer together. And then we have like a plateau and it drops off. So what we then also find here is like typical distances of these clusters to each other, because you have then an overabundance of, because all the stars in this cluster have basically the same distance to this cluster and vice versa. So you also, this is also then visible in, I guess, probably here in this kink. I'm not sure actually, to be honest. And then when you go to larger distances, this drops off because you have a much lower number of stars that can be actually 6, 7, 8, 9 degrees apart, because this is only possible for the thing from for the stars or the objects in the edge to the other edge. So the count goes down. And we have here the left-hand side, you also have here an overabundance for the lower stars. Then we have a gap in between, and then we have here the large-scale distribution of the field stars. Okay, so maybe I should do this larger again. Okay. So looking at these estimator plots gives us an idea of common and typical separations between objects in such a field, and whether this is homogeneously distributed or not. So again, the left-hand sky has a uniform background of 8,500 points, and we have additional 1,500 points in 25 clusters that are placed on a uniform 2x2 grid. So in such things here. So you see here it looks larger, and here and here and here you see some overabundance on the size of two, on a scale of 2 degrees, and this is here. So exactly where we go, where we have here again an increase in structure. While the second field has 10,000 points and another 2,000 points with a separation with a width of 0.1. So this is here, this peak. So this is how these statistical estimators extract typical distances from this field. Okay. Now, how to compute these estimators? This is basically done by computing the distance of one star between to all the other stars, and then counting how many stars have we in this distance bin, how many distances occur in this distance bin, and so on. So that's this DD quantity. So that's basically a number of distances that are binned. And then you compare this with a total random field where you don't put in any structure. And there you do the same and compute the distance of the one random star to all the other random stars, and then count how many distances you have in each bin. And this is this RR figure. And then scaling this with the size of objects in each of the two maps, this quantity W1 is basically the ratio of between the counts of our data compared to the random one. And this should be approximately 1. This number is basically 1 if our data is randomly distributed. So the whole quantity gets about 0, is about 0. Then of course you can somehow improve this by not doing one random field, but maybe doing 10 or 50 or 100 and then taking the average for all the bins or so. But this is then like fine tuning. And I already mentioned that this measure is biased. So Lundy and Salai published an improved estimator where they correct basically this figure here by looking at cross correlation statistics between our data and the random field. So where you basically look at the cross correlation. And it's computed by taking one star from the data and the other point from the random set, and then doing this for the whole thing. Okay. Now, from this point on, it's just simple arithmetic. So just simple computing, plus, minus, square root, and so on. It has the fine problematic point here that we have a terrible computational scaling working. Because computing this means I need to look at all the stars and compute the distance to all the other stars. So this is n times, basically, number of stars squared distances that I need to compute. Which means if we have 1,000 stars, we have 1,000,000 distances to compute. And if we have 10,000 stars, we have 100,000,000 distances to compute. And very rapidly, this becomes quite an effort for a modern day computer. So when you actually do this, you have to be somewhat clever on how to compute this and not compute things multiple times if you can avoid this. But this is just a side remark here. Okay. So when I look at my random fields, they have like 9,404 stars each. And I don't download the data actually because it would take too long for the computer. Well, maybe. Let's first look at a super simple example. So I just create like a small artificial set looking like this. And the only thing that I do is I shift this a little bit. And so these are 1, 2, 3, 4. So these are 16 stars in each field. And what I then need is basically the distance from all stars to all other stars. This is called distance matrix. In Mathematica, there is a function that computes this. And here we are only then later interested in either the upper half or the lower half, because we don't want to compute the distances double. But you see that point one has distance zero from point one. It has distance one from point two, distance one. It has distance two from point three, distance three from point four, and then again distance one. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 1. And then we have square root of 2 because of the triangle distance, of course. So this is how this numbers come up. And then now can take all the entries here and just count how often does every distance occur. Here, this is possible here because we have this regular pattern, so we don't have to bin, we can look at the actual number of distances. And this is this. So, two remarks, we have to throw away the zero because this is, of course, a zero information. And all the other numbers have to be divided by 2 because we count them twice here due to the like symmetric nature of the matrix. Okay, so maybe I just should define all the functions that I created here. And then I can also, of course, bin width doesn't work, bin number. So these are functions that I created that takes such a data set and bins it in a certain way. I made sure to include the maximum distance here, so we have in the first bin, which is probably between 0 and 1. Zero objects. We have 42 in the bin between 1 and 2. So this is 48 and 36 gives 84 divided by 2 is 42. And then you have, of course, to make sure that you don't count things that just are at the edge of the interval double and so. Okay, but anyways, so these are my bins. And this is the same for the second set that I shifted. And of course, a constant offset doesn't change anything, but okay. So, and this number of distances is basically what I compute here, dd. So this is 0 in the first bin, 42 in the second bin, and so on. And rr would be the same if I just compute a random field. So let's see, I think I create a random field here. Okay. I have two random fields. This one is just randomly created 10 positions in this box, and this is 10 positions in the box plus something in a smaller box. And I can now compute the same statistics here. Let me pull down these two and compute this. What was it? Rand 1 and Rand 2. Well, the system is slow here, sorry for that. And maybe, I don't know, 15 bins. Maximum distance is maybe, doesn't matter. So these are the distance bins here. So there are more number of stars here. That's why this count is higher. But we, when we look at the actual, when we look at the distribution, then we should see a difference. So let's see whether my function here properly works. So, yeah. Maybe let's do more bins, I don't know. Yeah. So here for, what is the x-axis? Ah, yeah, okay. X-range. Okay. Here my function doesn't work properly. But anyway, so the x-axis, ignore the x-axis. And we see basically that we have not a homogeneous distribution, but we have some numbers that are here higher than for larger distances. Maybe let's go through the large data set and then we can basically see what happens. So this is the data. And let's pull this down a little bit here. Ah, it's all the same size. Ah, good. Okay. Now, when I compute all these estimators, what I finally get, and let's ignore here all the code details, are these figures basically. The blue line corresponds to our W1 estimator, so the one that is biased, and the yellowish line orange line corresponds to the Landau-Scali estimator. And I used 100 bins. Here the x-axis is now just the bin number, so not the actual separation. But we already note that all the blue lines tend to behave funnily when we go to larger distances. And that is what is meant by this is biased. So that for large separation, this is statistically not representing the true underlying distribution. And when we look at the, so let's look at the orange line here. And keep in mind that I use different Y scales. So this is just automatically selected. Then the one thing that stands out is that when we look at figure at plot number two, so all of the plots show basically a flat line for all distances, which means all the distances are more or less equally common. Just here we have an overabundance for closed pair in data set number two. A little bit maybe here, but looking at the scatter, I'm not sure how true this is. And this is at least a factor of two higher here. So looking just at this estimator, my assessment would be that data set number two is actually the true star field, while all the other ones are basically randomly drawn from a random number generator. We can also then maybe look at take the running average of these data of the lines here to like even out a little bit the scatter here, and this is the running average, and here you see that data set number two basically still goes through the roof while everything else is zero, more or less. Now actually, what is actually then later computed is one plus this number, because and that's also plotted here, because of course on a logarithmic plot this estimator W can also become negative, of course. That's why I use the absolute value here, but we can also just add one, and then this should be a strong upload. And this is how the average looks like when I look at this biased estimator, and then you see that it's basically very difficult to make a statistical statement on how these figure. It's maybe the only thing is that all other fields except, no, that's also not true. So this kink here is visible in three or four, but not in all of them. Okay. So this is what I prepared here, just as an example, how these tools are used. When you want to really reproduce figures like these here, you have to think about logarithmic binning and plotting like how to plot this properly. So what is the error? What is this, the statistical uncertainty, and so on. So it becomes a little bit more complicated. And I started to do this here for the Q&A, but at the end it just took a lot of time, which is of course also understandable, because so this is not some toy example, but to do it properly it takes some effort, of course. So this was the example that I wanted to show.